went to a small city named Slough near to Windsor in order to visit the siblings Caroline and Wilhelm Herschel, who had constructed a huge telescope with which they were able to look far into the universe, and they even had discovered the planet Uranus with that telescope. When Joseph Haydn had gazed through this telescope, he was said to be fascinated and very pensive for a long time. He had viewed into spheres far beyond the horizons of music business. And it is said that this experience has influenced his decision to compose an oratorio, which we know very well, the Creation. When this oratorio, the Creation, was premiered in Vienna in 1788, this was an enormous success. And I have to admit that I felt the same kind of enthusiasm when I learned to know the piece at the age of 12. It was my first symphony concert, which I attended. And in my files, I even found still the libretto of Haydn's piece and some pencil marks which indicate that I apparently had at that time the crazy idea to compose the piece once again by myself. That such things are still allowed, I think, at the age of 12. On 1st January of 1801, the new century was celebrated in the intellectual center of that time in Germany, in Weimar, with a performance of the Creation of Joseph Haydn. And three leading intellectuals were present. This was Goethe, Schiller, and Wieland. Wieland was very, very enthusiastic about the piece. Goethe didn't say anything against his common attitude to comment anything, everything. And Schiller dismissed the piece completely, characterizing as a characterless mishmash, and adding the opinion that it is not the function of music to interpret texts and images, but to stay within the limitations of its own laws. Since then, we have the discussion on so-called absolute music and program music. Beethoven was not very impressed by this discussion, and he composed his sixth symphony called the Pastorale. In this symphony, he expresses not only his love to nature, but he even finds special expression for the brook, for the flow of a brook, for the steps of a wanderer. Call of birds are depicted, and with the characterization of a storm and tempest, he has accomplished something which he probably not could have done within the horizon of pure absolute music. Let's just listen a little bit to that episode of the Beethoven Pastorale Symphony. Please, track number one. Composer Hector Berlioz recognized this new way which Beethoven had started with the Sixth Symphony, and if we listen to the third movement of his Symphony Fantastique, the scene in the country, we hear clearly the link to the Beethoven Symphony. At latest at that point, the two lines were split, which became important in the 19th century. Schumann and Brahms thought they would have to defend the line of so-called absolute music, whereas Richard Wagner did not believe at all in a music which is separated from nature, life, and the other arts. So far, he confirmed what the philosopher Georg Friedrich Hegel had argued in his aesthetics, saying that the artist should not draw to the abundancy of pure abstractions, but to the richness of real and spiritual life. And that was the point of view where Gustav Mahler started when he began to compose his first symphony. Gustav Mahler had read a novel of the writer Jean Paul, the book Der Titan. At the beginning of this novel, the main person, Albano de Cesare, stands on the roof terrace of a castle on the Isola Bella, an island in the Lago Maggiore, a lake in the North Italian Alpine region. Albano is contemplating the nighty sky and experiences the gradual rising of the sun. And Gustav Mahler has found musical expression for this vision, which only can regard it as unique. 5 kilometers away from Isola Bella and 100 years after Gustav Mahler, I was sitting on the balcony of my apartment close to Lago Maggiore and watched the motion of the skies. And gradually, a sound image came into my inner ear with which I wanted to express the visual impression, but not in a way which would illustrate it, but in an inherent musical way. That means my idea was to give the clouds a voice. They should sing. At the same time, I was reading a cycle of poems of the German poet Hans Magnus Enzensberger. He had written a cycle of poems, The History of the Clouds. In this cycle, he gives the clouds a voice, he listens to what they say, and he speaks with the clouds. And although this is a very modern type of poems, one has to say that these poems are standing in a long line of poems and above all paintings which deal with clouds and other nature phenomena. I would propose that we should listen now to just the beginning of my piece, Song of the Clouds, which is the first piece in my cycle, Spheres. So let's take track number 2. phenomena of nature, such as air, water, earth, and fire, have always inspired the artists. And it was the Greek philosopher Empedocles who first qualified these as the basic elements in nature, and he even found correspondences for them in human psyche in the form of hate and love, of attraction and repulsion. And he also was one of the first to regard our universe as a sphere. The French philosopher Henri Bergson transferred this idea to human consciousness, and he created the term of the spheric form of consciousness, die Kugelgestalt des Bewusstseins, as we say. In the last 10 years, a younger German philosopher, Peter Sloterdijk, has published a monumental work of 2,500 pages titled Spheres, Sphären. It is divided in three volumes. The first part is called Bubbles, the second Globe, and the third one Foams. It is not easy to describe, and principally not my thing to describe it, but I will just give a small indication. He begins with a model of spheres in the uterus, and then he follows to the history of mankind according to the model of growing and growing spheres up to the multiple spheres in which we live our days and which overlap. That means we are living all in a private sphere, in a social sphere, in a cultural sphere, a spiritual sphere, and. And of course we are living in a physical sphere. The scientist tries to understand and formulate the laws of the physical sphere. The artist does it in a different way, and I want to make use of a metaphor of Peter Sloterdijk, which is quite nice. He says, regard the contents of a physical or a spiritual sphere as like a good old wine. And before you drink the wine, you should decant it. That means you should pour the wine from one vessel to another one, and during this procedure, the wine is infused with oxygen. That means it is refreshed, it is reanimated. And that's something similar which I did when I added electronic sounds to the traditional orchestra. That means I try to refresh the conventional sound of the orchestra by the new means of electronic music, in the case of spheres, by live electronic and not by edit tapes. That means I add new tone colors. Tone color. The word alludes already to the visual, to the image. And the word image is the nucleus of what we call imagination. And one could put the question whether imagination in general is possible without the infiltration of the visual, of the image. Maybe an exterior visual aspect or an interior image. Whatever. I have called the six pieces of my cycle spheres, 6 Klangbilder, 6 sound images. Each of the pieces has its own sound character, its own instrumental color. All the pieces are linked by a basis structure, which I call a Klanggestalt. That's something which I will describe later on. I do not want to describe the single pieces with my own words, or even interpret it. That's not my thing. I just want to give the titles. First, Song of the Clouds. Second, Play of the Wind. Third, Layers of Earth. Fourth, Rain Canon. Fifth, Firework. And the sixth piece is called Morning of Spheres. I'm not the first, of course, to make use of the term image in music. 100 years ago, the French composer Claude Debussy composed a cycle consisting of 3 pieces called Images, Image. There's another cycle called Trois Nocturnes. And at the beginning of this cycle, there's a piece titled Nuages, Clouds, a little bit similar to my piece. And I would propose, sorry, that's my watch. And I would propose that that we just listen a little bit to the beginning of that piece of Claude Debussy, and you will see and hear perhaps some similarities, but certainly also the difference between the two pieces. If we could just listen to track number 3. Some of my earlier pieces, orchestral pieces, such as Mythos, Black Peninsulas, Dream Play, and Aura, I have chosen the subtitle Klanggedicht, sound poem, because these pieces refer to literature and to mythology in a certain way. But these are not symphonische Dichtungen, symphonic poems in the sense of Franz Liszt or Richard Strauss, because my pieces follow to an autonomous musical form, which I will describe later on. But they relate to an aspect, to a general aspect of poetry in the form. Normally, the basis of a poem is a first line, which corresponds in music to a measure. If we add several first lines, we get a stanza, which corresponds in music to a phrase or a period. several stanzas make a poem in music, a piece, and several poems give a cycle or an epos in music, the large form. And to organize these different layers of form, I have created a theory which I have described in an article about 20 years before, named Gestalt, Komposition oder die Konstruktion des Organischen. Gestalt, Composition or the Construction of the Organic. There are two terms which seems to be important, Gestalt and Organism. As much as I know, the term Gestalt is used in the English-speaking world in the same way as in the German. That means, simply described, a Gestalt is more than the addition of its parts. It is a kind of an entity. And that is the same which has to be said of an organism. An organism is much more than the addition of its components. It is a coherent system. And now we come to a nearly philosophical point of my thinking. René Descartes and Isaac Newton have regarded our universe as a kind of a clockwork, as a kind of a mechanism, and if an element of this clockwork is broken, they thought it could be rather easily be replaced. This does not at all correspond to the thoughts of physicists and philosophers of our days. For example, I think of Fritjof Capra, which should be well known here in America. He is living in Berkeley. He has published a book, The Turning Point, published in 1983. In this book, he says, this world is not at all a clockwork. It is an organism. It is a living organism, a dynamic, energetic system. And we cannot at all replace something which is broken simply by other functions. So that is a very different way of thinking from that one of Descartes and Isaac Newton. And this is also reflected in a certain way in my theory of the Gestalt composition. That is to say, the Klanggestalt for my piece Sphären, spheres, consists of 27 tones. They include all the 12 chromatic pitches of the octave, but it is not a simple addition of the tones, such as it was done in the serial music. I use the tones for an evolution, for a logic development. So, it is at first a kind of a melody developed according to logical criteria. But at the same time, this Klanggestalt gives me the harmonies. That means it consists of four phrases, and each phrase transferred into the vertical dimension gives a chord of a certain complexity and a character. And these chords are responsible for the whole cycle of spheres. And moreover, I use the Klanggestalt by transposing it to the time dimension, and I derive a Zeitgestalt. And with that Zeitgestalt, I organize just these time layers which I have mentioned before, of the measures, of the phrases, and sometimes even of the global form. Just a moment, I have to fix it in my memory. what I want to say. Okay, but the idea would be wrong if one would think I use this structure in an automatic way. I would say this Klanggestalt can be regarded as a genetic code for the whole piece, but the code is not the creator. And so there is no automatism, and I often quoted a sentence of Gregory Bateson, who said in his book Mind and Nature, rigor alone is paralytic death, and imagination alone is insanity, which is quite wrong. Of course, absolutely right. And so my composing moves between rigor and imagination, between restraint and freedom. Freedom. The impressionistic painters were the first who left their dusty ateliers in order to paint in the open air. And this was an act of freedom, certainly. Composer Claude Debussy took this as a model when he tried to discover new territory for his composing. He left the conventional forms of the sonata and the fugue, and he left the Wagnerian modulation harmonic system. He was much more interested in the waves of the sea, but in the four-part counterpoint, which he was, of course, skilled in. But he took another approach when he began a piece. It was less a motive or a theme, but at first a kind of a vision, a sound image, which stood at the beginning of the procedure. And that is something which became very important for the further evolution of modern music. That means this trying to find a specific constellation of sound, of harmony, of instrumentation, and so on. And that was a way which began with Debussy, went via Arnold Schoenberg up to electronic music of our times. But one has to say that for Debussy, the sound itself was not the aim of the whole procedure. It was a medium to express what he wanted to say. He looked for characters, for images. And in order to give you now another idea of my sound images in spheres, I would like to play another sample for you. It is the beginning of the fifth piece named Firework. And so let's just listen to the next take. After having completed this fifth movement of the cycle, my wife died, and I decided to add a further movement with the title Mourning of Spheres. This is something which I have again derived from the book of Sloterdijk, and I would not like to describe too much now of this piece. I would prefer to listen together with you just to the beginning of this last movement of my cycle Spheres, the Mourning of Spheres. Let's take the next example, please. That's a shame. Sorry, that seems to be a mistake on the CD, which I complain very much. I don't know why it is as it is. And so we have to stop now my lecture, and I hope that I was able to give you a certain impression of the link between the visual and the auditive in music and how it works in my thinking and in my music. Thanks.